Welcome. In this unit, you will learn about ecological engineering for disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation. The two guiding questions of this unit are: what is ecological engineering and what are its potentials and limitations? So, what is this ecological engineering? Well, there's ecology and engineering in it. For sure, you are aware of engineered infrastructure for disaster risk reduction. And you have already heard about ecological infrastructure for reducing disaster risk during the past units, right? If you now combine aspects of both engineered and ecological infrastructures, then you have a hybrid solution or ecological engineering. But let us take a look at the engineered or built infrastructure for disaster risk reduction first. For sure, you've already seen many examples, such as dikes, embankments, or seawalls. They are mainly designed for specific functions such as protection from floods, waves, or wind. Sometimes they provide additional benefits such as storage for drinking and irrigation water or generation of hydropower. However, such measures often are very costly and maintenance intensive. Furthermore, they are designed for only a limited lifespan. Especially in the context of climate change adaptation, the scale of solutions needed to adapt to increasing weather extremes is sometimes hard to predict. And engineered infrastructure, like seawalls or dikes, may not always be feasible due to the high costs and technological requirements. However, because the benefits and performance of technology are more easily quantifiable than nature, in reality there can be a bias towards engineered solutions. Even though ecological infrastructure for disaster risk reduction can be less costly and more locally feasible. You have already seen this graph on benefits of Eco-DRR. In many cases, maintaining and restoring natural infrastructure can offer a high benefit-to-cost ratio compared to built infrastructure, when taking into account the full range of benefits provided by ecosystems. For example, coastal greenbelts or wetlands as natural buffers are often less expensive to install and maintain than engineered constructions over time. In addition, they also provide supplementary co-benefits regardless of a disaster event. In comparison, engineered infrastructure like dikes or concrete walls fulfill the same main targets, but comparably less co-benefits. Yet, ecosystems also have limitations. Installing ecological infrastructure is time-consuming. For example, trees need time to grow before the forest can provide effective protection from landslides and avalanche. Ecological infrastructure should not replace other critical life-saving disaster risk reduction measures, such as early warning systems, preparedness, and adequate contingency planning. But it can be an additional alternative. It is critical to involve environmental experts and have them work with disaster risk experts to do site and context-specific planning. Ecological infrastructure can fail as well, for example, when long-term maintenance is not guaranteed. In some cases, natural buffers are not feasible due to biological limitations, space constraints, incompatibility with priority land uses, or prohibitive costs. Another important aspect is the available space. Especially in urban areas, land is scarce and there may not be enough space for ecological infrastructure without major relocations. Let's imagine a city built around a river and see how ecological engineering can be applied in this case. Riverine cities are usually built just up to the waterfront without any retention areas. Such cases require cooperating on a river basin scale to create room for natural water retention further upstream. The urbanized areas can then favor engineered structures like flood protection walls. This is what we call a hybrid solution or ecological engineering, combining both ecological and engineered infrastructures. Sometimes ecological engineering may be the most effective and appropriate solution. In this example from Indonesia, mangrove belts are used hand-in-hand with engineered coastal defenses. Similarly, wetlands can be used to reduce wave action to protect human-built levees, increasing their effectiveness and lifespan. To be effective, The use of ecosystem-based activities requires reliable data on hazard frequency as well as a good understanding of the local geo-hydrological and ecological conditions. In recognizing the benefits of ecosystems for disaster risk reduction, one must also be aware of the limits, which depend on the type and intensity of the hazard, the type and health of the ecosystem, and the correct application of ecosystem management. The need for combined solutions using hard engineering options also depends on the local context. For instance, using forests to stabilize avalanche-prone slopes reduces the frequency of avalanches, but not the fact that avalanches will still occur under specific conditions. Coming to our second question, what are the potentials and limitations of ecological engineering? Well, combining natural and engineered measures makes sense, because a combined approach can benefit from the potentials of both types of measures and address multiple hazards, for example, protection from flooding and landslides. Combined natural and engineered solutions can complement each other and minimize limitations. And hybrid solutions are often required in densely populated areas where land is scarce and can also address both short and long-term priorities. Cost efficiency of hybrid solutions has been proven by various case studies. Take the example from New York City, where the gray infrastructure of the sewer system was in urgent need for upgrading with estimated costs of $6.8 billion. Instead, the city decided to invest in a green infrastructure plan, which cost $5.3 billion. The plan includes green rooftops, green sidewalks, upstream and urban wetlands, and ponds for cooling the city, aesthetics, and for stormwater retention. In addition to its initial lower cost, over time the benefits of green infrastructure accrue while gray infrastructure requires renewed investment after 10 to 15 years. To sum it up, ecological engineering is a no-regret strategy and it has already proven to be effective. That's the good news. But it won't be the cure-all solution as it can reduce but won't eliminate all risks. Both ecological and built infrastructure for disaster risk reduction have their limits and opportunities, their pros and cons. Where the ecological system is not critically damaged, they can be complementary and combined. For an engineer who is usually trained to think in engineered solutions, it is certainly worth considering hybrid solutions for reducing disaster risk and adapting to climate change impacts. The same is true if you are more on the environmental management side, trained to think in terms of green solutions. Thank you, and don't forget to take a look at the additional materials provided for this unit.